have three sermons prepared for tonight, and it was just a Russian roulette of which one God was going to say to do. And this is the one he laid on my heart, and so I wanted to just share with you, as I shared with you earlier, that we talked this morning about what Jesus prayed for and the importance of us going to him and praying for the things that Jesus prayed for. The key to it is learning when to go. And you know, the best time when it comes to praying about something, when should you pray? Scripture tells us to pray without ceasing. So the communication line can always and should always be to some extent open. But it's interesting in our lives, how often do people see us and have it notated about us that we inquired of the Lord before we did anything else? And each one of us would say, well, there's circumstances and situations in my life where I don't know that I can just do that. You know, decisions have to be made sometimes very quickly, and I just don't know that I could do that, and Pastor, you just don't understand. But it's interesting, and the things I'm going to share with you tonight about David's life, each one of them has a topic to it, and I want you to know that if David can inquire of the Lord, we have no excuse. Because the things that he inquires of, in most cases, are going to be bigger than the things that you'll have to deal with in your lifetime, in some instances, but some of them hit you right between the eyes as it hit me. Between the eyes. So before you think I'm offering this up to you and saying, you scoundrels out there, I want you to know that my life is in this message as well. So as we look at this, I'm going to first of all ask you to turn to 1 Samuel. We're going to start at about chapter 22, actually 21, because it tells a story. And this is a place where David's men are hungry. He's being pursued by Saul. And as he's being pursued by Saul, he goes to the priest at Nob, and he says, hey, we need some food. And this is where they gave his soldiers the holy bread that was there. And they partook of it, and they ate of it. And David said, do you have a sword or a spear or any kind of weapons? And the priest there told him, yes, we have Goliath's sword. And you can take it if you want it. And so he takes it. Well, David leaves with the sword and everything like that, but when Saul's shepherd, who was there that day, one of his sheep herders was there, and he saw what happened, and Saul, he got close enough to Saul, he told Saul what had happened that day, and here's what Doeg said about David when he went to the priests and asked for the food and a weapon. Then Doeg the Edomite, who was standing by the servant of Saul, said, I saw the son of Jesse coming to Nob to Abimelech, the son of Ahitub. He inquired of the Lord for him, gave him provisions, and gave him the sword of Goliath, the Philistine. When we read about that in chapter 21, as it unfolds in chapter 21, if you notice I'm in 22 right now, when you unfold that in 21, there's never a point where it says, and David inquired, but we find that the guy who's the enemy of David is saying he inquired of the Lord, or had Abimelech inquire of the Lord about what he should do, and he got the sword. I wanted to just give you that one because somebody I know, before the night was over with, or before the week was out, somebody would come and say, there's another time that it says that. Well, I know that story, and it really doesn't pertain to anything other than the fact that Doeg, of the enemy, the ones trying to kill David because he worked for Saul, he said that David had Abimelech inquire of the Lord for him. And so it tells me that he saw something there that may not have been in chapter 21, but it was in 22, and that's what his testimony was to Saul. So, as we continue on in our little jaunt through scriptures, now I'm going to ask you to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 23. Have you ever had somebody in your life who just felt like you needed a rescue? And when you don't ask the Lord if you should or not, and you just go in and take it upon yourself, whether it's a child, or it's another person, or a friend, or something like that. Have you ever noticed when you don't inquire of the Lord, how that usually turns out? And a lot of times when you're helping them, there's this little voice in the back of your head called the Holy Spirit saying, what are you doing? Why didn't you ask? Not so that you could have permission, but there's some things that God wanted to tell you about this situation that's going to hurt you down the line. But you see, we have in our minds and our brains today, let's just help everybody. Let's just do everything for everybody. You know, one of the things that troubles my heart is I see a lot of parents who got kids who are 20 and 30 and 40 and 50 years old, And they're still treating them as if they're 12 and 13 or 6 or 5 or 4 or even 1 or 2. Because the child can say, oh, the sky is falling, and mommy and daddy just come running. Now, the help that we're going to talk about here, there's a city that's being just tormented by the Philistines. Now, David, who was anointed by Samuel earlier, David's anointed by God through Samuel. David knows what he's going to be one day because he was anointed to be king over Israel. He knows that. And the enemy is attacking this city of Israelites. Now, I don't know about you, but it seems like the smart thing to do is what? Just go take care of the enemy. Fix it. They shouldn't have to go through this. And isn't that the mentality that we have a lot of times when we're helping somebody? Oh, poor them, they shouldn't have to go through it. How do you know that what they're going through isn't what God designed for them so that they can come out on the other side having been tested and proven and shown the perfect will of God? How do you know that? Well, if you never ask the Lord, how will you ever know that until you're on the other end of it saying, oh my goodness, why did I ever get involved? You ever been there? Yeah. Well, it's interesting because David has this scenario. And I got to tell you, if I were to say, hey, there's a city being attacked over there, we need to go do something, I would hope and pray that before you just jumped on a bandwagon and just went running off with me, as a lot of people do, I would hope that you would stop and say, have we even prayed about this? Have we even inquired of the Lord if this is something He has for us to be involved in? Are we close enough to Him to believe that He would answer us even about something like that? You see, this is our pride that says, I can help things. I can do things. I got to tell you, this is one of the reasons I'm not trying to be mean to people, but I say, I can't fix you. If God says to help you by saying something to you, I want to say what God wants me to say to you, but I don't want to say another word. Not because I don't care, but because I realize God is doing a work in you just like He is in me. If I don't know when to speak and when to shut up, then I'm not listening to the things of God. So, when we look at this story, let's just start off in verse 1 there in chapter 23. It says, 1 Samuel 23, verse 1, and they told David, saying, behold, the Philistines are fighting against Keilah and are plundering the threshing floor. So David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go and attack these Philistines? And the Lord said to David, go and attack the Philistines and deliver Keilah. But David's men said to him, behold, we are afraid here in Judah. How much more then if we go to Keilah against the ranks of the Philistines? Then David inquired of the Lord once more, and the Lord answered and said to him, arise, go down to Keilah, for I will give the Philistines into your hands. So David and his men went to Keilah and fought with the Philistines, and he led away their livestock and struck them with a great slaughter. Thus David delivered the inhabitants of Keilah. Now here's the thing. You see the picture how it unfolds? I want you to kind of put yourself in David's shoes. A bad thing is happening, and we want to fix it. Well, even his men were like, wait a minute, we don't know. We know that David had 600 men. We don't know how many Philistines were attacking. We don't know that. The men could have been fearful, but both times, even with the fear of the men and knowing what was happening to the city, what the Philistines were doing with them, David on both occasions still did what? Ask God. Ask God, and God said, go. Not only to take care of the Philistines, but tell your men to go, I said so. It's going to be okay. You asked, and I told you to go. There's so many stories in the Bible, and one of the other messages I have is all the different stories out of Judges and all the way back into Genesis and all the different places where people came up with the idea. They birthed it in their brain. They thought of it, thought it up and everything, and they get on the precipice to do it, and they go, whoops, did anyone ask God? Nope, okay. God, is it okay? You know what? Aren't we more like that than what David did? He knew what the situation was, but he knew he still needed to first inquire of the Lord. Even when people need help, even when people are right there. Now, I'm not saying, you've got to remember that Nehemiah, in a split second, when the king says, why is your countenance low? And Nehemiah, what did you do? First thing, right there in the presence of the king, prayed. So it's not like you have to give a 45-minute prayer before you do something. Lord, is this what you want me to do? Did you bring me to this place for such a time as this? and be about whatever he tells you to do. Because there's sometimes that events do take place, but the key to it is, are we even asking? Are we even saying, Lord, what would you have me do? Sometimes, and in most cases, we have time to think about these three tragedies that come up in our lives. And if we would stop and inquire of the Lord and say, what would you have me to do? Before we reach out and start trying to help. Some people say, oh, that's what you're supposed to do as Christians. You're supposed to reach out and help. Wait a minute. I'm just saying that David waited and he asked the Lord, what do you want me to do? Do you want me to attack? Do you not want me to attack? How much time transpired through this? I have no idea. But he still asked before he acted. And the key to this, do we ask before we react? Most of the time, we live in a world where everything is reaction. If you don't believe that, watch the news. Christians, of all people, we should be the ones that say, wait a minute, let's look at this. Lord, what would you have us do? Well, second thing that I see is when someone's trying to hurt you. First of all, when people need to be rescued, you have the story of David, and what did he do? Even though the Philistines were the enemy, they were tearing up the threshing floor, they were making it hard for these people, he still asked the Lord. Even when his soldiers were scared, he still asked the Lord. The next story that we're going to be looking at is one where even though someone's trying to hurt him, David still inquires of the Lord. He doesn't presume upon the Lord, I know what you're going to tell me to do. He still waits on the Lord. In 1 Samuel chapter 23, same chapter, look at verse 9. We begin in a different story as it continues on. He hears about these things, Saul does, and in verse 9 it says, now David knew that Saul was plotting evil against him. How many of you have ever had somebody try and do something to hurt you? Just know that they're trying to hurt you. Okay, well, Saul's not just trying to hurt David at this particular juncture. He's trying to kill him. How many people are trying to kill you? Probably very few, if any. But David knows that Saul is trying to kill him. So we could say that David knows that Saul is trying to hurt him. Can we agree on that? So, in the course of all of this, in verse 9, now David knew that Saul was plotting evil against him. So he said to Abiathar, the priest, bring the ephod here. And David said, O Lord God of Israel, your servant has heard for certain that Saul is seeking to come to Keilah to destroy the city on my account. See, he's still in the city. He's still there. He's been the hero of the city. But how quickly people turn against you. And he asks the Lord, he says in verse 11, will the men of Keilah surrender me into his hands? Will Saul come down just as your servant has heard? O Lord God of Israel, I pray, tell your servant. And the Lord said, he will come down. There wasn't any, well, let me explain all the stuff. No, they said, he'll come down. Okay? Now, David had heard these things, but before he listened to the gossip of all the things that took place, what did he do? Before he reacted to, hey, he's coming. Before he went, oh my goodness, the sky is falling. What did he do? He asked the Lord, is he coming? Is this really true? Now, I've shared this with you on many occasions. Here's a wonderful time for me to just elaborate on this. How many times has somebody come to you and said, so-and-so said this about you? Or so-and-so did this against you? Our first response is to what? Be mad and angry and react. Well, I'll just go and tell them just da-da-da-da-da. Or if you need to, you run. Whatever the case may be, you make your decision based on what somebody else said. And what David did was he said, Lord, is this true? Is this true? I have found if we will ask the Lord if it's true, he'll reveal to us if it's not or if it is. He does it all the time. He wants the truth to win the day. But Christians have to be willing to say, before I'm going to jump to the conclusion that somebody's just told me that this is going on, before I do that, I'm going to ask the Lord, Lord, is this really what's happening? Is he coming? Will the men surrender me? And the Lord said, he's coming. And then he goes on to say that they'll surrender him as well. In verse 11, will the men of Keilah surrender me into his hand? Will Saul come down as your servant has heard? O Lord God of Israel, I pray, tell your servant. And the Lord said, he will come down. Then David said, will the men of Keilah surrender me and my men into the hand of Saul? And the Lord said, they will surrender you. He had just done a great thing, a helpful thing that God had told him to do in Keilah, and yet they would be be willing to surrender the one who just delivered them from the enemy? I got to tell you, have you ever felt betrayed? But here's the thing. God told them, yes, they will. And yes, he's coming. And yes, this is going to happen. But could you imagine if David just had to speculate on all these things? If he did what a lot of times we do, don't inquire of the Lord, don't ask the Lord anything. He could have got his men could have heard that, he could have got his men all riled up, and what do you guys want to do? And they could have done things that would be disastrous to the will of God, not because God's will could be torn apart, but disastrous at the point that God says, I got this, let me do it my way. Disastrous is when we try and get in there and try and change the things of God. But instead of doing that, what does David do? He asks the Lord. So, as you look at this, even when someone's trying to hurt you, even people that you just helped. Did you catch that? Even the people you just helped, ask the Lord. He'll give you direction on what to do, and you'll find that oftentimes you'll have enough time to think and to meditate on what God would have you to do. It doesn't say that Saul was going to be there in 15 minutes. This probably could have been 3 or 4 days away. This could have been a day away. I don't know, but he had time enough to think. And if you think about it, so much of the time, the decisions that you and I make, we've got a little bit of time to think about. The first thing we think about is our situation before we think about God knows your situation. It would be great if we could start with, hey, God knows what's going on. Lord, what would you have me do? Even when people are going to hurt you, we know Saul was trying to, but the people were about to turn David over. They were about to hurt him by giving him over to Saul. And so David didn't assume, hey, they can take care of me because I've done this and I've done that. And he didn't assume that. He said, Lord, what do I need to do? He goes on to say, verse 13, then David and his men, about 600, arose and departed from Keilah. And they went wherever they could go. They left. But it wasn't under a scramble. It was they left knowing that it was God's will for them to leave that place. Knowing what was about to happen. So, we've looked at people that need to be rescued, and we saw what David's response to that was. Someone trying to hurt you, trying to kill you, even those whom you've helped in the past. The best thing to do is inquire of the Lord. What about when somebody takes something from you? Steals something from you? Look with me at 1 Samuel chapter 30. The story is that the Amalekites made a raid on the Negev, which you can look at that in your Bible maps and stuff like that. But here's the key. David and his wives and all of the men of Israel and their wives and children, the 600, the men were out taking care of business, and the women were there, and the Amalekites decided to make a raid on the city. They didn't kill anybody, but they took everything. Here's the story. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 1 and 2. Then it happened when David and his men came to Ziklag on the third day that the Amalekites had made a raid on the Negev and on Ziklag and had overthrown Ziklag and burned it with fire. And they took captive the women and all who were in it, both small and great, without killing anyone, and carried them off and went their way. Now, those of you who've served in the military, you know that when you come back from a deployment, you just want to have some time to just kind of decompress. And if you're out in the field and you've been in conflict and in the battle, when you come back, you want to just crater right there on your bed and try and forget the moments that you've just gone through or the hours or the days you've just gone through. That's what soldiers want to do. They had just come back from battling. They had just come back, and as they come back where their wives and all of their kids and everything were, has been burned, and everybody's been taken. You're tired. If you go on with the story, they were really not happy with David. In fact, you'll see that in verses 6 through 8, moreover, David was greatly distressed because the people spoke of stoning him. His own men were talking about stoning him. As a pastor, I've been there once or twice. It's not a fun place to be. For all the people were embittered, each one because his sons and daughters But David strengthened himself in the Lord. Then David said to Abiathar the priest, the son of Ahimelech, please bring me the ephod. So Abiathar brought the ephod to David. David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I pursue this band? Shall I overtake them? And he said to him, pursue, for you will surely overtake them, and you will surely rescue all. That's pretty specific, isn't it? It says nobody was killed in the raid, and that you will rescue all of them. Well, as the men leave out, headed to pursue them, if you keep reading the story, as they went out, 200 of them fell behind. In fact, they came to a river, and the guy said, we are just too weak. So now David is pursuing this band with 400 men. They stay behind because they're too weak. They were so weak. Think about it for just a minute. How weak you must be if somebody had your wife, your daughter, your son, or a family member. How weak you must be to say, I can't go any further. That's pretty weak. And I'm not saying these were weak men. I'm just talking about they were tired. They didn't have the strength to continue on. But David and 400 continued on. And they pursued them. They caught up with them. And they took back what had been taken from them. All of it. Just like God said. You see, David was probably just as tired as his men. You ever make decisions when you're tired? You ever stop and pray about them before you make them? Usually you're so tired that you don't think about saying, Lord, what do I need to do now? I am beat. I'm bushed. I'm tired. Lord, what do you want me to do? Well, in this particular case, something had been taken. And the tragedy of that, you've ever been violated by having somebody broke in your house? I know several of you in the church have had somebody break into your house and they've taken things from you. They may have taken little trinkets or big things or whatever the case may be, but it's not about what they took. It's about the violation of having it taken. And if you know anybody who's ever had a child that's been kidnapped or anything like that, in our world today especially, oh my goodness. And rightfully so, it should be something that's big, but you know the agony that those parents go through. Can you imagine? These men were still the same way back then. They loved their families. They were coming home to their families, and the families were gone. But David, even in the midst of it, when he said the right thing, he could have just said, the right thing to do is for us to go after them. Let's go, guys. What does David do? Because God may have had another enemy come and wipe out the Amalekites, and guess what? Their families could have come back to them, and God could have brought them back any way he chose to. But David said, should we go? And God said, yes, go. I'll give it all back to you. Go get them. And he did. We don't know how God's going to work in situations or circumstances of our life, but we ought to be asking. Even when somebody has taken something from us, we still, even though we're tired, we need to make sure that we're making wise choices based on what we've prayed about to God. What would you have me do? Many of you, I sit here and I look out over the audience, and many of you are looking at me like, seriously? Pray about everything? Let me share with you, the closer that you get to God, it isn't going to be something that somebody's telling you to do. It's something you will automatically do because of that relationship with God. And if this is kind of like weird to you, may I encourage you, start talking with God. May I encourage you, start studying His Word and find that everything that I'm sharing with you now, I can share them with great conviction because it's true. I can share these things with you because once you get close enough to the Lord, and once you may be saying, what, are you better than us? Absolutely not. But the closer you get to Him, the more that you will understand this conversational communication that you can have with Him. I'm not saying He appears to me in the mornings when I'm shaving in the mirror. I know who that is in the mirror, and it ain't Him. But the reality of it is, as you get closer to Him, you start depending more and more and more on His guidance. You know what it is to listen to Him and to hear Him. And if it sounds foreign to you, let it be a challenge then, not a scolding, but let it be a challenge to say, I want that kind of relationship. I want to inquire of the Lord when my life is not going the way it should. I want to ask Him. I want to be able to look to Him and let Him make the decisions of my life. Well, we see this story. The people wanted to stone David. He was tired just like they were. But God said, go, and I'll give it all back to you. So, as we've looked tonight, we've looked at people that need to be rescued. We've looked at people that are trying to hurt us, and in his case, trying to kill him. We've heard of people that are taking things from him. Now we come to a place where there's a death, and it's an important death. If you look with me over in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1, there's an important death that takes place. And at the end of chapter 1, you will find of 2 Samuel, you will find that David has a dirge about Jonathan and Saul. Saul has been killed. Saul was the king, and David was his enemy to some degree. At least Saul felt that way. But David still paid proper honor to Saul, even in his death. And he inquires of the Lord because at this point he knows that he's been anointed by Samuel to be king. Saul is now dead, so God is going to put him in the place of king. Could he not have said, I've been anointed by Samuel to be king? Could he not have said, you guys come on and let's do this all together? But instead, David played diplomacy in all of this. He honored Saul. Even though Saul was trying to kill him, he still honored him. And before he took any steps to try and control the kingdom, which he had rightful ownership to through the anointing of Samuel, before he even did that, knowing all that he knew, he still inquired of the Lord, what should I do? If you look at this, you'll see the story in 2 Samuel chapter 2, verse 1. Then it came about afterward that David inquired of the Lord after the death of Saul. David inquired of the Lord, saying, shall I go up to one of the cities of Judah? And the Lord said to him, go up. So David said, where shall I go up? And he said, to Hebron. Do you get this? It wasn't just, okay, Lord, I'll go up. That's all I need. I just need to know you wanted me to go up. Lord, where do you want me to go? Do we get that particular with God? Lord, I know you want me to do that, but what do you want me to do? And how do you want me to accomplish it? Notice the questions that he asks here. He says, shall I go up to one of the cities of Judah? And the Lord said, go up. And David said, where shall I go? And he said, to Hebron. The specificity of this is to say, and we need to realize this, when we ask God specific things, he will show us specific things. When we just say, yee-haw, I got permission from God, so I'm going. Lord, where do you want me to go? I know you want me to go up, and where do you want me to go up? There were many cities that he could have gone to. But God said, I want you to go to Hebron. And from that particular place, God blessed David by what he did. In fact, if you go on and read the story, he honored the men that took care of Saul and buried him and treated them with great respect. And this could have been a time when David said, I'm king, I've been anointed, God anointed me through Samuel. I'm king. You have to just accept this. He could have. But instead of taking it on himself, he still said, Lord, what would you have me to do? I know what you've done, Lord. But still, what would you have me to do? How often do we come across situations in our life where things have changed? In this case, it was death. And in that change, we start making decisions before we know what God would have us to do. Think about it. When somebody dies, one of the things that they say, don't make any major financial decisions within the first year. Don't give anything away. Just stop right there for at least 6 months. Don't be giving out everything to the family. I don't know how many times I've talked out with folks who've lost their mate and they gave all the jewelry out and everything like that, and they just did it because they weren't thinking and because and they gave it to the wrong people, and that hurt feelings, and all the other kind of stuff that go along with it, and have to get it back and give it to this and that. Just a mess is made. Don't make any decisions. Well, before David said, yee-haw, I'm king, he said, Lord, what do you want me to do? And he followed what the Lord said to do. So we see in this, after death, even the death of his enemy, David still sought the Lord. He still sought out what God would have him to do. This is one of the things that I tell folks who've lost a loved one. Before you do anything, ask the Lord what he wants you to do. Ask him to open the doors up for you and what you need to be doing. And the Bible tells me with a great confidence I can share with them that he will show you if you ask him. If you're looking for his will, he'll show you. But you've got to ask him. David and all of this still treated the dead body of Saul with great respect, and those who dealt with Saul with great respect as well. You see, David wasn't looking to just bring Judah together. He was looking to bring all of Israel together. And that was God's plan, because David did what God said to do and didn't go up to the rightful place where he should have gone, or to where everybody else might have gone and said, "I'm in charge now." What David did was he said, "Lord, where would you have me go?" And the people came to him, because God brought them to him. He knew where he needed to be, and God blessed him because he inquired of him what to do. You see, I understand that we can make all kinds of decisions in our life. We can choose to do this and this and this. And we think that all of our decisions are without any consequence, or most of them, and we don't think through our decisions. And the reality of it is, they have consequences. And wouldn't it be better to ask God before you suffer the consequences of a poor decision? Wouldn't it be better to say, "Lord, what would you have me to do?" But because of our pride and our selfishness, we say, "No. I know what I should do." But isn't it cool that as we look at David and we see this, we see that David still is inquiring of the Lord. You know, the last couple, actually, I've got three more for you, and two of them are together. So let me do the 2 Samuel chapter 5. Both of these, this happens twice. And if you read chapter 5, verses 17 through 19, chapter 5, 22 through 24, you'll think you're hearing the same story. But you're not. It's two different stories. David is now king. In verse 17 of 2 Samuel chapter 5, it says, "When the Philistines heard that they anointed David king over Israel," remember I told you God had a plan? Judah came to him and made him king first, but then Israel saw how he treated Saul with respect and everything. They came and said, "We want you to be king too." So now he's king. The Philistines heard that David was king. You have to remember there was a time that David was with the Philistines while Saul was chasing him. And so now the Philistines come and say, "This guy must be pretty weak." So, it says, "David king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to seek out David, and when David heard of it, he went down to the stronghold. Now the Philistines came and spread themselves out in the valley of Rephah. Then David inquired of the Lord, saying, 'Shall I go up against the Philistines?'" Notice the first thing he did was seek sanctuary. He went to a safe place, and then he inquired of the Lord, "What do you want me to do?" I love that. "Shall I go up against the Philistines? Will you give them into my hand?" And the Lord said to David, "Go up, for I will certainly give the Philistines into your hand." Now, I had somebody say one time, anytime David inquired of God about anything, God said, "Absolutely, you go right ahead." But if you look at the next story, which is in verses 22 through 24, now the Philistines came up against him again and spread themselves out in the valley of Rephaim. Then David inquired of the Lord. He said, "You shall not go directly up." Aha. So there's times that God says, "No, don't." But he did tell him, "I want you to circle around behind him, and I want you to do it the way I tell you to do it." So not only was it, "Do I have permission to do it?" But I have instructions for you. How many times in your life have you listened for not only the yes, but also the instructions on how God wants you to do it? Can you see how that would just be a really close walk with him? "Lord, not only am I going to hear you say yes, but I'm also going to hear you give me the instructions, and I'm going to follow your instructions." And it says he did exactly what the Lord told him to do. So, we see in both situations, in fact, one of them is one of the clues that I gave to the kids about a year ago. And in verse 24 of chapter 5, it said, "It shall be when you hear the sound of marching in the tops of the balsam trees, then you shall act promptly, for then the Lord will have gone out before you to strike the army of the Philistines." It's awesome. God says, no, "This time I'm going to do it. I just need you to follow my lead. You're not going to do it. I want you to follow my instructions, and I'm going to do this, and then you follow my lead." Wouldn't it be great to just be working so closely with God to say, "Gotcha"? Wouldn't it be, I long for that kind of relationship. And I would hope that everyone who's a Christian would long to have that kind of relationship, not only to get the yes and no's from him, but how he wants it done. You know, through his word, he gives us a lot of that. So we see this, and in both situations, they win over the Philistines. So even when the enemy attacks I think of Satan and how he's going to continue to attack. Notice it happens twice. The Satan just wants once you've handled the attack and God has blessed you and everything, does Satan go, I just guess I better go back to hell because they're safe now? Or does he continue to attack you? Does he continue to throw things in your way and things to cause you to stumble or cause you to falter or do things you should? Do you ever have those days? Yeah, he doesn't just stop. He keeps going. And the enemy here, every time when David was faced with the same problem twice, both times he asked, Lord, what do you want me to do? And one time God said, I want you to deal with it this way. And the next time God said, I want you to deal with it this way. How about you? You ever been like that? God says, wait a minute, here's how I want you to do it. Okay, Lord, I'll do it that way. And God says, but I want you to handle it this way. You know the story, if I can, that story of Eddie Vega? And you say Jesus Christ all the time. Remember the story? I won't retell it because you've probably heard it a million times. But every time the Lord just said, be quiet. Be quiet. And then one day the Lord said, why don't you start using his name? And I don't take any credit for it. And some people go, ah, that's a good idea. It wasn't mine. God put that in my head. And about the time that I did that, I was going, wow, thank you, Lord, because I was tired of being quiet. The reality of it is God will say, wait a minute, wait. Now do this. So we see this, the repeated attack. But finally, there's a time in David's reign in chapter 21 of 2 Samuel. A little bit further back to chapter 5 or chapter 2. In chapter 21, you can also find some of these in 1 Chronicles. Some of these stories as well, and you'll see the same thing there. In 2 Samuel chapter 21, verses 1 through 6, what about when it's time to restore somebody back? Have you noticed when you're angry with something, how your life just kind of falls apart? You ever notice that anger and frustration and all those kind of things, do they build you up or do they kind of tear you down? They tear you down. Well, what's happening is in Israel, there's a famine taking place. In fact, we pick it up in verse 1. Now there was a famine in the days of David for 3 years. 3 years, year after year. And David sought the presence of the Lord. And the Lord said, it is for Saul and his bloody house because he put the Gibeonites to death. What had happened was, Saul, when he was king, acting as king of Israel, he killed these people. And there was a massacre that took place. He had made a deal with them, and then he crawfished out of it. And it created a great deal of harm to the Gibeonites. And it goes on to say in verse 2, so the king called the Gibeonites, David, called the Gibeonites and spoke to them. Now the Gibeonites were not the sons of Israel, but of the remnant of the Amorites. And the sons of Israel made a covenant with them, but Saul had sought to kill them in his zeal for the sons of Israel and Judah. Thus David said to the Gibeonites, what should I do for you? He inquired of the Lord, and the Lord said, this needs to be fixed. How many times in our heart do we know that we're at odds with somebody, and God says, this needs to be fixed. This needs to have something restorative, something that brings you back together. There doesn't need to be these feelings that are there. There doesn't need to be this animosity or this hate there. So David says to him, what should I do for you? And how can I make atonement that you may bless the inheritance of the Lord? Now listen to me. This wasn't David's problem. David didn't do this. You get the picture? He didn't do it, but he knew that he was responsible. And the best way that he could deal with it was to inquire of the Lord, what should I do? And the Lord said, make this right. And so they do. Then the Gibeonites said to him, we have no concern for silver or gold with Saul or his house, nor is it for us to put any man to death in Israel. And he said, I will do for you whatever you say. So they said to the king, the man who consumed us, which was Saul, and who planned to exterminate us from remaining within any border of Israel, let 7 men from his sons be given to us, and we will hang them before the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, the chosen of the Lord. And the king said, I will give them. You see, this could have just continued on. How many people carry things that should have been restored years ago, carry it around, and it just continues to fester and makes it worse and worse and worse and worse. And they never say, Lord, why is it this way? What's going on in my life? Why am I feeling the way that I feel? Is there something that needs to be restored? Is there something that needs to be made right? They had suffered 3 years of famine, and finally David said, Lord, what's going on? And the Lord was glad to tell him, this injustice took place, and you need to fix what's taking place. And I'm telling you, you need to work this out. And God gave him the words, and God gave him what he needed to do. But you see, sometimes when things aren't going well in our life, the first thing when he says, Lord, what am I doing? Is there something that's not right about me? But here's the thing. If we never ask that question, we will always think we're right, will we not? If we never inquire of the Lord and say, what have I done? And be willing to listen to him, we will always think that we're right and there will be no restoration. There will never be a time to bring all of this back together. Tonight, as I've done these several scenarios, these pictures of David, we're going to close in just a moment. I want to thank you for listening very carefully to each one of these stories and seeing how David, in the midst of some of the very things you and I face every day, how David still made a point of talking to God about all of this. Even when it was imperative, when people were in peril, even when it was critical, even when there was restoration, even when he could have done this, but God said, do this. Now, we do know that there was a time, I don't want to make David out to be one of the greatest men that ever lived, although God said he's a man after my own heart, because there was a time when he didn't inquire of the Lord. He didn't say, Lord, should I be out with my men fighting as all the other kings were? He didn't ask that. In fact, he just stayed at home. And of course, we know the story of Bathsheba. There are many times David didn't inquire, but these are the times that he did. And because we see these, prayer, communication with God, how important it was for him, and while he was communicating with God, God blessed his life and did great things, and he brought glory to God. And isn't that what we want to do? Bring glory to God.
Amen.
So, no matter what's going on in your life, are you inquiring of the Lord? Are you asking him anything? Because we've seen here that everything that we go through, others have been through, and God has answered those who ask. That's why when it says, if you'll ask, I'll do it. If it's according to my will. And all that David was doing, saying, Lord, is this according to your will? And God answered it every time that he asked. It's awesome to know that God will answer you if you ask him. So you're saying, well, I asked for this or that the other day, God didn't answer me. You still haven't been listening to the sermons. Okay? So we'll talk later. But right now, let me encourage you. You inquire of the Lord about the things that are his. I guarantee you he'll answer you every time. And if you want to bring glory to him, that's his stuff. And he'll tell you that.